Let's look at a simple linear regression example. We've been doing a lot of work in bits and pieces, and let's try and bring a few of those ideas together here. A study investigated a possible relationship between eggshell thickness and environmental contaminants in brown pelican eggs. As part of the study, a possible relationship between shell thickness and DDT concentration was investigated using a sample of 65 brown pelican eggs on Anacapa Island in California. DDT is a pesticide that has some harmful side effects and was banned from many places back in the 70s. Here's a plot of shell thickness versus DDT for this sample of 65 eggs. It does appear, to my eye at least, that there is some sort of trend there, that there is a decreasing trend of shell thickness with DDT. And assuming a linear relationship here probably wouldn't be the worst model in the world, although there might be some other models that we might consider. We typically fit a line through points using the method of least squares, and we typically use a computer to do so. The estimates that make up our least squares line are given in this column of the output. This second line here represents our slope, and the first line represents the intercept. And so our estimated slope in our least squares regression line is -8.732 × 10⁵. And if you're unfamiliar with scientific notation, this simply means move the decimal place over 5 places, and so this is -0.0000872. And so our least squares regression line, and this is then simply y hat, is equal to our estimated intercept, which is 0.4231 -0.0000872 × x. Let's see what that looks like on the scatter plot. Here's our scatter plot with the least squares regression line superimposed, and it looks like a pretty reasonable fit, at least to my eye. Now we can use this regression line for prediction. So suppose for the sake of argument we had another egg from a pelican on that island that had a DDT concentration of 2,000 parts per million, and we wanted to predict its shell thickness. Well, we would simply go up the line and then go over here and get our estimated shell thickness like that. But to do this with a little bit more precision, we'd just throw 2,000 into the regression line. What is the predicted shell thickness for a DDT concentration of 2,000 parts per million? Well, 2,000 is our x, and we simply substitute that into the regression line. And if we were to carry out those calculations, we'd see that our predicted y value is 0.24846 millimeters. And so our predicted shell thickness for a DDT level of 2,000 parts per million is about 0.25 millimeter. What proportion of the variability in eggshell thickness can be explained by the linear relationship with DDT? These 65 eggs have some variability in their shell thickness. They vary from a high of about here to a low down here somewhere, and there's some variability. That variability is made up of two parts. Part of it is due to this decreasing trend that we see here, the fact that shell thickness tends to decrease as DDT levels increase. And so there is a decreasing trend that we see here. But part of that variability is due to simple random variability about that line as well, unexplained variation. So part is due to this decreasing trend, and part is just due to random variability about the line. It can be shown that the proportion that is due to that decreasing trend is r squared, the square of the correlation coefficient. R squared is sometimes called the coefficient of determination, and it is the proportion of the variability in the response variable y that is attributable to the linear relationship with x. And we can find r squared in our computer output. Here, we have something called multiple r squared, which for our purposes in simple linear regression is just r squared. And our r squared then is 0.3202. And we might say something like, in our sample, 32% of the variability in eggshell thickness can be explained by the linear relationship with DDT. The other 68% is random variation that is unexplained by this linear relationship. Now we might want to carry out some statistical inference. We might want to see if there is significant evidence of a relationship between eggshell thickness and DDT. But before doing any statistical inference, we should check the residual plots to see if the assumptions of our model are reasonable. Our simple linear regression model assumes that the theoretical error terms are normally distributed and have constant variance and are independent of one another. And plots of these residuals, the observed residuals, which are the observed value of y in the sample minus a predicted value from the model, can help us check to see whether those assumptions are reasonable. What we are hoping to see most of the time in a residual plot such as this is simply a random scattering of points, nothing indicating a problem with our model. So our model assumes constant variance. So if we were to look at this, there doesn't look to be a lot going on here. The variability in the residuals looks to be fairly constant as we go along. Might be a little bit low over here, but that's no big deal. I say that constant variance is pretty reasonable here. There doesn't appear to be any systematic curvature in our residuals, and nothing indicating that our assumed linear relationship between the variables is not reasonable. And there's no major outliers or any problems like that, so I'm going to give this the big check mark and say that residual plot is pretty reasonable. We can check the normality assumption by doing a normal quantile-quantile plot of the residuals. And if our residuals are approximately normally distributed, the normal quantile-quantile plot will result in an approximately straight line. And I think that's a pretty reasonable normal quantile-quantile plot. Looks like that to my eye anyway. So I'm going to give this the big check, say that's okay, and say it's okay to go ahead with our statistical inference procedures. A natural test to carry out is of the null hypothesis that there is no linear relationship between y and x. In symbols, we're testing the null hypothesis that the true slope beta 1 is equal to 0. And this simply means that there is no linear relationship between eggshell thickness and DDT concentration. To carry out that test, we use a t-test. And our t-test is our sample slope minus the hypothesized value, which is 0 in this case, over the standard error of our sample slope. And these values are found in the output, so our beta 1 hat is given right here as minus 8.732 times 10 to the negative 5. And we subtract off the hypothesized value of 0. And in the bottom, we divide by the standard error of beta 1 hat, which is given right beside beta 1 hat in the output, as 1.603 times 10 to the negative 5. And if we work that out, we would see that this is equal to minus 5.448. But that's given right here in the output as well. Next, we need the p-value. And assuming we're using a two-sided alternative, then what we would have here is our t-distribution with the appropriate degrees of freedom. And we would put in our observed test statistic of minus 5.448, and our p-value is simply the area in the tail beyond this test statistic doubled. But the good news for us is that that is already given in the output right there. So the p-value of this test, we didn't really have to do any of those calculations, because our p-value is equal to 9 times 10 to the negative 7, or 0.0000009, a very small number. A very, very small p-value, giving us very, very strong evidence against this null hypothesis. So we have very strong evidence that the true slope is not zero. But what does that mean in the context of this problem? What that p-value is telling us is that it would be very, very, very unlikely to see a decreasing trend like this due to chance alone. And that there's very, very, very strong evidence that there is a real effect, and that as DDT level increases, shell thickness tends to decrease. It would be very unlikely to see something like this due to chance alone, so we have very strong evidence that this is a real effect. Note that this was an observational study and not an experiment, so even though we have very, very strong evidence of a relationship between shell thickness and DDT, we can't say that an increase in DDT levels causes this decrease in shell thickness. It may very well be that an increase in DDT does cause a decrease in shell thickness, but this type of study cannot reach a conclusion of that strength.